Hi everyone! In the last video, we completed our discussion about fatigue failure and discussed some fatigue life prediction methods. In this video, we will be talking about creep testing and phenomenon, its mechanisms, and strategies for improving creep performances of metals. Let's begin. Creep is a time-dependent and permanent deformation process that is affected by temperature and applied stress, which can be a limiting factor in the lifetime of parts in high-temperature applications. Generally, creep behavior starts as the homologous temperature goes beyond 0.4 due to the increased atomic mobility at higher temperatures. As a result of which, the strengths of materials decrease. Among metal, ceramic, and polymer material families, polymers are the most sensitive material group to the creep deformation. Yet the effects of creep on the lifetime of a part can be decreased by choosing a material having higher resistance to creep, or creep resistance of materials can be modified by enhancing the oxidation resistance and high temperature strength via surface modification or strengthening process. But before getting ahead of ourselves, let's get more familiarized with creep testing and time-dependent generalized creep behavior. The engineering creep curve of a material is obtained by applying a constant load to a tensile testing specimen at a constant temperature. Then, the strain of the specimen is determined and plotted as a function of testing time for creep analysis. When examining a typical constant load creep curve, as the load is applied, we see an instantaneous deformation denoted as epsilon zero that is mostly elastic. After the instantaneous strain, primary creep begins, where the creep rate is continuously decreasing. During the primary creep stage, the material experiences an increase in creep resistance as a result of increased strain hardening. Primary creep stage is followed by secondary creep stage, where the creep rate is nearly constant due to the balance between competing strain hardening and recovery processes. The slope of the curve at this stage is the minimum creep rate seen throughout the whole creep process and is the most important design parameter derived from the creep curves. As the material is deformed further, it enters the last stage of creep called the tertiary creep. At this stage, the creep rate accelerates rapidly and eventually material fails. This failure is often termed rupture. Tertiary creep starts as the cross-sectional area begins to reduce due to necking or internal void formation and increases the strain rate with increasing rate. During this stage, microstructural changes such as coarsening of precipitates, recrystallization, or diffusional changes may occur in the phases present. After getting familiar with creep stages, now let's take a look at the creep testing, its details, and its interactions with experimental conditions. Creep tests are conducted at constant temperature, under constant loading, and sometimes under constant stress. Even though the constant load creep tests are more relevant to the conditions of daily applications, constant stress creep tests are sometimes performed to develop a deeper understanding of the fundamentals of the creep processes. Although the creep testing procedure is simple in principle, depending on the selected testing conditions, it may take as long as months, even years. The creep behavior of a material depends on the applied stress and temperature. Creep tests are usually conducted at low stresses to avoid tertiary creep, since the main goals are to obtain the minimum creep rate and to precisely determine the strain. Unlike the applied stress and temperature, the loading direction does not affect the creep properties of most materials. Yet, uniaxial tensile loading is employed for most metals, as it offers a simpler experimental design. Additionally, the metal samples having dog bone geometry are employed for testing. However, for brittle materials, creep tests are conducted under uniaxial compression rather than uniaxial tension. Uniaxial compression is employed to prevent any stress amplification due to the presence of surface or internal cracks under tensile loading. Furthermore, For creep testing of brittle materials, cylindrical sample geometry, which is similar to 3 and 4 point bending test samples, is employed. For a given material, during creep testing, temperature or applied stress can be altered. So long as the testing temperature is less than 40% of the absolute melting temperature of the material, only the primary creep stage is observed. However, as temperature goes beyond that limit, material starts showing secondary and tertiary creep stages as well. Additionally, further increase of temperature under the same stress value will lead to an increase in the initial elastic strain value, which will also increase both the minimum creep rate observed at secondary creep stage and the rate of increase of strain at tertiary stage. For a given temperature, increasing applied stress also negatively affects the creep performance of a material, leading to an increase in the initial elastic strain, minimum creep rate, and the rate of increase of strain before rupture. As stated before, the minimum creep rate is obtained at secondary creep stage, and it is used as a design parameter for applications where there will be constant temperature and stress, and there is no tolerance for failure or a lot of straining, and the part is expected to operate under these conditions for years, if not for decades. Yet, in addition to long service life applications, there are also some applications where short service life under creep conditions is expected from the part. For such applications, time to failure under the given creep conditions is the major design parameter. To be able to collect that data, creep tests must keep going until the failure of the material, being called rupture. The time passed until the rupture of the material under given loading and temperature conditions is called the rupture lifetime, and is denoted as TR, and is usually reported in hours. Unlike in creep curves, the rupture data plots have stress at y-axis and rupture lifetime at x-axis, and both are plotted in logarithmic scale. For the rupture tests, often an inversely proportional linear correlation between the applied stress and rupture lifetime are observed for each temperature. As a rule of thumb, higher stress values lead to shorter rupture lifetimes for a given temperature. Furthermore, for a given stress value, increasing temperature dramatically decreases the rupture lifetime of the component. In short, increasing stress and temperature increases the amount of plastic deformation and atomic mobility, leading to the rupture. As articulated before, depending on the testing conditions, creep tests may run up to months or even years. To not spend that much time collecting data for creep behavior analysis, an empirical correlation between the creep strain rate and the applied stress is developed, enabling the rapid creep behavior analysis for a variety of operating conditions. The material is assumed to have a steady-state creep rate for this empirical approach, where epsilon naught S stands for the creep rates in percent elongation per hour, K1 and N are material constants, and sigma is the applied stress in megapascal. However, since the diffusion is an exponential function of temperature, an Arrhenius-type equation where the testing temperature included as a parameter is developed. Here, K2 is a material constant, QC is the activation energy for creep deformation in kilojoules per kilomoles, R is the universal gas constant being equal to 8.314 kilojoules per kilomole Kelvin, and the T is the operating temperature in Kelvin. As we are done with creep testing, creep stages, effects of stress and temperature on creep and rupture curves, and empirical correlations, now we can move on to the strategies for improving creep performances of metals. First of all, only primary stage is observed so long as the operating temperature is below 40% of the absolute melting temperature of the metals. Then, any metal having higher melting temperature will have some inherent advantage compared to those with lower melting temperatures. Although having a high elastic modulus does not necessarily improve the high temperature resistance of metals. It offers higher mechanical properties, enabling lower creep deformation for a given operating condition compared to a metal with a lower elastic modulus. Another alternative can be solid solution alloying of the metal, where it will be employed for introducing secondary phases to the system, which would enhance the creep behavior via manipulating the microstructural processes. Lastly, the material at hand can be replaced by nickel-based superalloys, which is a promising material family exhibiting extensive creep resistance and high temperature strength compared to conventional steel, aluminum, or other alloy families. They can exist in equiaxial, directionally solidified, or even single crystal forms. The Inconel Hastelloy, Haynes, and Rene families are common nickel-based superalloy families, having many specific compositions defined by the standards. Despite their costs, nickel-based superalloys are sometimes the only material family that can be employed for high-temperature applications. The suggestions so far just focused on replacing the material. But what if the material replacement is not an option? Then what? We should keep in mind that some of the microstructural changes take place at or around the grain boundaries during creep deformation. So, less grain boundary area means a smaller number of sites available for microstructural changes leading to creep deformation. Moreover, larger grains will inhibit the grain boundary sliding compared to smaller grains. But it should be kept in mind that larger grains will lead to a deterioration in the mechanical properties of metals at lower temperatures, where the creep behavior is not seen. In case the metal is used at both high and low temperatures, then it should be deformed at room temperature to elongate the grains for having high aspect ratio. Then, this metal will offer improved mechanical properties both at room temperature and at elevated temperatures, enhancing both creep properties and mechanical performance. Yet, it should be kept in mind that this modification will lead to high anisotropy in mechanical properties of the materials. Lastly, precipitates can be introduced to the microstructure, which will improve both mechanical and creep properties by obstructing the dislocation motion and grain boundary migration. Finally, here are the creep testing standards. Now we have reached the end of this video. Next one will be the last video of the mechanical properties of materials subseries, and we will be talking about the failure mechanisms and go over a few case studies. See you on the next one.